It's raining outside, so thank you for coming down here and spending your time. Do you guys know them all? Maybe or maybe not. I'm gonna have them kind of introduce themselves and their business and what their current product is, so you guys know the background, and therefore you can get the context of where they're coming from.
Hey, how's it going? Good evening. I just had a nice drive up from Orange County, so thanks for having me. My name is Carl Choi. I'm not Korean, so hope I didn't disappoint anybody, but I grew up within the Korean community pretty heavily, so I know both of these guys for many years now. Quick background, I am currently running an artist collective called The Great Company. And what it's defined by is the great company that you're surrounded by. Because in my many years of business, I just felt like at the end of the day, that's what matters. It's the people you surround yourself with. So no matter what kind of business you're in, marketing, media, entrepreneurship, it all comes down to the people that you put around yourself. A little bit more background, I was born in Hong Kong, came here when I was 8 years old. And one of the things I always say is I never knew I was Asian until I got here. And so I grew up in the suburbs, and growing up in the suburbs was very interesting because in a way I had a little bit of an identity crisis. So throughout my teenage years, I was really searching for that. So when I got to college, I got to join a lot of different organizations like yourself and was able to partake in really finding my Asian community. So rather as the Chinese associations, KSA, I was involved in all of them, just name them. And after a while, for one reason or another, I started putting groups of communities together because I realized, man, if these different communities can work together, we could do a lot. And so I started throwing parties. And these parties eventually evolved into an entrepreneurial endeavor. What was very interesting was, I think probably like these guys, I also had a day job coming out of college. So I spent about a year at Anderson Business Consulting, so that kind of introduced me to the IT world. And then after that, my boss one day told me to meet him at an address in Marina Del Rey. And I said, why? And he said, because I want you to come with me to this next job. And that job turned out to be Lionsgate Entertainment. And so I joined Lionsgate when there were about 72 employees that just moved down from Vancouver. And it was an amazing experience watching something turn from 70 employees to about 250 in that year. After that second year, I decided to move on, and I have been my own business ever since. So as a serial entrepreneur through my 20s, went into all kinds of from party promotions to DJCity.com to digital promotions, across the board. And so about 5 years ago, I decided to take a break, and then 3 years ago, I decided to start the Great Company. I guess we can go more into the other histories and the different projects I was part of later, but that's me. Thanks for having me.
Hi, my name is Danny Cho. Hi. First of all, in college, I was James Han's roommate.
Congratulations.
Nothing to congratulate me. This should be more Bruce on your face, but I'm a stand-up comic. I'm a writer, movie producer, actor. Currently, I have two projects. One is a movie I made called K-Town Cowboys. It was thank you. It was selected to the South by Southwest Film Festival this past year. We had the most screenings out of every movie there. We sold out almost all of them. The one was like at 2 p.m. and we saw White Harmonies there. I was like, why are you watching my movie? But yeah, they seem to enjoy it. And the other thing I'm working on is I recently shot a comedy special that I plan on putting up to Netflix and Hulu and iTunes called Kings of K-Town. It's me and two other comics, PK and Walter Hong, and we just shot it. These two were in attendance, and it was really, really good to see the community come to support me. I mean, I've been doing stand-up for 15 years. Right out of college, I was a business consultant. I worked at evaluations arm of KPMG, and I did that for 3 years. And then once I paid off my parents' mortgage, I said, Oma Appa, sorry to disappoint you. I'm gonna be a tantara. And so yeah, you know, they couldn't say anything. I paid their house. What are they gonna do? So and that was 8 years ago. So yeah, that's me.
Hello everyone, my name is Young. This is my brother, if you haven't noticed, this is my brother Ted. We're from Soul Sausage Company. I guess you probably know us from the Food Network's Great Food Truck Race. I think it was like 3 years ago now that we were on that show, but there's a lot of work that we put into it before that show. Hopefully we can share some of those stories with you today. Me and my brother both came from advertising. Before that I was in a band. I actually did some stuff with Carl, like over a decade ago, but you know, everybody has their own journey and their own paths, and it's great to be here with you guys, and anything we could do to share some of that knowledge and just you know, being different and not having a set path. I think that's something that we all share, so hopefully we get to share some of those stories with you. And if there's anything I missed.
Not much, but you guys, I'm Ted, the other half, brother of Soul Sausage. Yeah, y'all pretty much covered it. What's a cool story about Soul Sausage was it was a passion project. It started out of our chef's apartment, and we just started doing festivals and just thought it was a really cool product. And we never sold out. We kept everything authentic. And we really made the right decisions along the way and helped us get to where we are. We currently have a restaurant and two food trucks. We have another restaurant opening up in about a couple weeks. And we just got back from Korea. We did a 10-episode series with CG Entertainment and CBS, so that should be coming out soon. And yeah, just we love sausages.
Alright, one of the reasons why we got this panel is because we're a generation where offline and online business are both in the mix. We have to balance to really strike the chord of our audience here. And I want to know how you guys manage online and offline business and how those two things balance each other out to kind of take care of your operation, your marketing, or whatever else you have going on for your company. So how is the online and offline task?
Well, for me, because I'm an entertainer, for lack of better words, I gotta be famous here, right? And the story about K-Town Cowboys, the movie that I did, came about because about 5-6 years ago, I did this video where I was in a dress and I was talking like a K-Town girl, you know? And as I was seeing it being edited, a director friend of mine and I were like, oh, let's go get drunk. And so we got drunk, but we were talking about our stories that we went through. This director guy had no experience directing anything more than a music video. I had no experience writing anything outside of like a small man TV sketch or whatever. And I was like, all right, let's do it. And we shot it for $5,000, not knowing what the heck we were gonna do. And then we put it online thinking everyone hates it. Because you know what I mean? Like Koreans hate their own people the best. You know what I mean? Koreans don't like to see other Koreans do well all the way. You know what I mean? Like in the beginning, oh, he's Korean, that's awesome. And then once he gets, you know, like in Lost, what was the first thing all Koreans said when they saw Lost? Why can't Daniel Dae Kim speak Korean properly? Right? Right? That's what they say. But I was like, he's in one of the biggest shows on TV history. You know what I mean? There is no opportunity for us to do that stuff, you know? Anyway, so I thought people were gonna hate the web series, and then they watched it and we got a lot of good feedback, and to a point like Daniel Dae Kim and people that were in the industry that was like, yo, what can we do to make this bigger, help you guys out? And so we decided to shoot a movie, and you know, by that time I had more experience, everyone had more, got better, and people like Ken Jeong, he's in our movie, he's also the executive producer of our movie. Daniel Dae Kim came through. I don't know how old you guys are, but when I was a kid, there was a movie called Best of the Best, and the guy with the eye patch, Simon Rhee, kind of looks like him, but with a different, you know what I mean? And And you know, these are heroes of mine because I don't know about you, but I've been doing stand-up and been in this business for 15 years. And so when I started till now, like there's a lot of advancement, but I don't think it's all the way there, you know? And so when I put it out, we made the movie. And the thing about my business is I can see clearly that when I do shows right after the web series, I do stand-up or whatever, there's more people. I go, hey man, come to be at the Laugh Factory, right? And then before the web series, before me in a dress, or before me looking like Kim Jong-il in a sketch, or whatever it is, like, people are like, yeah, whatever, you're a talent show comedian. You know, they look at me like you're an amateur. But after like things like that happened, more people came. So I think the synergy between online and for entertainers is that you get to reach more people outside of trying to be on a TV show or a movie, you know, big movie. So it gives you more avenues to reach your fan base. And, you know, that's how I'm here, eating free food. Oh my god, so no, but yeah. Yeah, so yeah, that's me.
You know, we actually, like, just going back to our story of when we originally started, social media was everything, because when we did these events on the weekends, we just started building a Yelp profile, and we did not know the power of Yelp until we started our restaurant. And Yelp is kind of one of those things where you, like, love it, but you also hate it. And we just kind of, when we first started, we were so hot on Yelp. Like, we just did festivals and events, and people would rate like 5 stars, like, this is amazing, this is so ingenious, so brilliant. And that's really how we started. We got the best of Yelp without a restaurant or food truck or anything. And we had about 140 reviews. And that was to the point where they put us on the front page of Yelp saying, like, this is the hottest restaurant in LA right now. And we didn't even have a restaurant or a food truck. And that was kind of like our pivotal point when me and my brother were like, maybe we should do something about this. And we actually wrote a business plan. We pitched it to some of our friends, family, anyone that was interested. And they were like, oh my God, I heard about you guys. I heard about you guys through Yelp. And that's how we started. It's just, you know, being able to just get those screenshots and show them, like, look, we're serious. We are on the top of the Yelp list. And, you know, people actually write great comments about us. And that's really how we locked in our first investment deal for our first store. Nowadays, we're at about like 1,000 reviews, and people complain about everything. Parking sucks, 1 star. You guys don't sell beer, 1 star. You know, it's like, really, man? But you gotta kind of roll with that. But just within like the 3-4 years that we've been in business, like, the internet has advanced so far, like, even beyond what we expected. And it's such an integral piece to our business. And a lot of these mom and pop restaurants don't have the ability to wrap their head around it, and it's such a missed opportunity. But luckily, me and my brother were from the ad world, and that's what we did for a living. We did digital advertisements, digital promotions, campaigns, all that stuff. And we literally applied all that to Soul Sausage, and I think that's one of the reasons why it was so impactful. And even to this day, like, there's so many startups coming up with food, because if you think about it, everybody eats, right? There's so much money that goes into the food industry, and these tech startups are trying to figure out a way to capture you know, that business. So every day we get like, oh my gosh, we have this new app, just check it out. It's like, dude, you're like the 4th person that emailed me today, you know? So a lot of that stuff's happening. Like, delivery online is huge right now. People don't do it because they think they're gonna lose money, but it's such another, like, it's another sales avenue that a lot of these restaurants aren't aware of. And we make 10% of additional revenue because of delivery, you know? And that's just beginning. So when people start figuring out how to use, like, online versus actual, I think that's going to be kind of like the sweet spot, especially in the restaurant industry. Can you say anything?
I mean, you know, with the whole Kogi movement there, you utilize Twitter. We just downloaded Periscope a couple weeks ago, and we did that for the first time. Soul Sausage is just kind of in a unique position where we're kind of like a media company, but a food restaurant. So people want to know, like, our story of, like, how do you make a restaurant, like, what are your steps? And so just kind of harnessing some of these tools out there, I think, for a modern day company is very important. You know, you have to be flexible, you have to adapt to the growing customer base. I mean, I'm sure you guys right now, while we're talking, you checked your phones like 5 times, right? So like now, if you want to make a dinner decision, you check your phone. And so these are the things that we're thinking about. Obviously, there's definitely the offline component of you have to come to our store, but you know, like pictures and like, you know, geo-targeted, all these things are gonna just impact the way you think about how you order food, and you don't even know it yet, but you know, like people are already starting to get to your head, and it's gonna be very interesting where it's gonna be in like 3 to 5 years.
So I was driving like 2 days ago, and I was using Waze. I don't know if you guys use Waze, but I was driving home from work, and all of a sudden my Waze, like, it's giving me directions, right? And this Jack in the Box ad pops up. It's like, hey, there's a Jack in the Box coming up. And it's like, oh my gosh, how did you know I want a Jack in the Box? And you stop by Jack in the Box and you eat it, you know? So it's just the way people interact with food. I know it's digital and you can't eat the food digitally, but it's coming together, and it's kind of crazy.
조르지 마세요.
주파치 타코스. So online offline. So I think for me, I come from a more behind the scenes scenario, and so I think online offline is more important than ever today. It's about engagement, and so they feed into each other. And so a lot of times when people say the internet, I want to do something on the internet. You know, the internet is a place full of everything, and often the secret is the niche. And if you could claim a niche with a special appeal, that's where you can win. And offline will always be important because that's actually where people get to touch, taste, feel, see. And so often your online is pretty much your billboard, and your offline is basically where people can engage with you. And the more you can engage, the more you'll feed your online. And the more you can be consistent online and be special online, how you portray your brand and stand out, the more you'll feed your offline. For example, I think even, I would say, one of the earliest times in my career, just kind of going back to music, this rapper named MC Jin, he was he had one BET 106 in the Park 7 weeks in a row. And that was before websites were really happening. And his clip went around via email for the most part. And people actually downloaded these clips and they went everywhere. What was interesting was because at the time, internet wasn't the biggest thing, but his influence was through the niche of being an Asian rapper, which just wasn't there at the time. But now you search Asian rappers, there's like 50 of them, so it's not that special anymore. So over time, it kind of grows and changes. And there's a season where even for online businesses, you didn't really need that offline presence as much, but I think as it becomes more competitive, now even TV is starting to gain its power back because it's also adapting a lot of where online is going. And online is no longer as much of a grassroots anymore because even on Facebook, you can't, you know, organic traffic doesn't really exist anymore. And so a lot of the landscape's changing, and I guess the next thing after online would be mobile, which I think now is where a lot of advertising is going. But often I think history repeats itself, and as much as it was important for artists to tour and to be engaging their fans, I think more than ever, artists have to be on the road. Just as brands, just as comedians, just as, you know, food trucks have to be on the road, that's where you're able to gain the true engagement, the true support. Because I think more than ever, people value that live presence. So that's my experience.
Okay, I have a question for Carl. I think the audience doesn't fully understand what the Great Company does. Can you talk about what Great Company does, and also how does online resources impact the creativity or the work that you do?
Yeah, to be honest, I'm still trying to figure it out. But I think it's worth a try. And often in any entrepreneur situation, you're always figuring it out. I would say this is probably one of the biggest puzzles I've ever faced in my life. I've always traditionally been all over the place. And so I've been very lucky to have been part of many fun projects. But I think this one has been one that has been ambitious in nature. Now, what we call ourselves is an artist collective. And what the recent scenarios that has been happening has been, I guess, to the three clients. There's three clients that I work with mostly right now, Microsoft, Nike, and Pepsi, all great, great brands. But I think they're also trying to figure out, you know, where they want to go as far as engaging the markets, because you can't go around and throw Pepsi everywhere, right? Because it's a brand, it's everywhere, but often it's part of a brand identity. I don't know if you guys serve Pepsi or Coke, but the puck or either, but it kind of becomes a brand identity of something else. And so they came to us and said, hey Carl, we spent all these years borrowing brand identity. For example, you know, Pepsi's really good at borrowing the Beyoncé's of the world and say, hey, we're right next to Beyoncé. But that's only because, you know, they have the cash. But then what happens when you think Pepsi, you don't really think the identity of who they represent. It's almost kind of like if you were to look at Pepsi and Coke, Pepsi is kind of like the little brother. While Coke has their bear, and you think Coke, they have a very strong identity with their Santa Claus affiliation. You look at Pepsi, you know, dyeing their hair every year, changing their looks, and it's almost like the can gets refurbished every year. And so I think right now one of the major explorations of what we're doing with them is helping them find that identity within their brand. Specifically a couple heritage brands that we're relaunching next year within the Pepsi umbrella. We're actually leveraging some of the upcoming artists. I think often my experience, I've worked with two groups. One is Jin, and the other group was Far East Movement. From the conception of the group till when kind of the louder noise started happening. And so for me, I think where I love and love putting my energy into has been identifying artists that I believe will be very successful and engaging them to get them where they need to be. Now, I think where it's interesting on my part now is I am able to work with multiple artists and leverage a brand resource to help them get to where they need to get. And so we're in a very ambitious project with Pepsi now in engaging several creators who I really believe will be very powerful in the next couple of years, and we will be able to get, partner with Pepsi to get them to where they need to be. And so in a way, I wouldn't say we're like an agency, I wouldn't say we're like a production company, but we're, in a way, I'm representing the artist on their behalf, engaging different brands to help them align their visions and their strategies in a way that it would be a win-win situation. Less transactional, more community and collaborative driven.
Thank you. So question for Danny. I think one of the biggest impact this internet has on the industry is content distribution and way people consume media. And as a creator of media, how is the industry doing things differently now that Netflix and now Hulu and Amazon Prime is entering the game? How do you do your differently?
Well, especially in the movie industry, when back in the days when you saw a movie, I went straight to DVD, didn't go to the theater, and everyone went, it's not a good movie, you know what I mean? But you know what the crazy thing is now with things like Netflix, Hulu, Amazon Prime, Vimeo's, you know, doing like stuff. Honestly, if you can make a feature film for less than $250,000, you'll make money. It doesn't have to be great, you know what I mean? Like, for example, horror movies, you know, the scary movies. If they don't sell here, they'll just sell to Germany or some other crazy country that likes horrible movies, you know what I'm saying? Like, but at the end of the day, like, there is a market for that. I know people that make millions of dollars for making movies that you've never heard of. They're straight to Netflix, you know what I mean? Like, you know that movie, Badass? You know what I mean? But then you'll see like Badass 8 and you're like, I don't even know who this guy is. You know what I mean? Like there's companies that get Transformers and then they make a movie called Transmorphers and you're like, this is awful. But those fools make money. You know the Shark Tornado, or have you seen those crazy movies where they jump out? Sharknado, where the shark eats the Golden Gate Bridge and you're like, what? But those movies make money, you know what I mean? And like, as an artist, I don't want to make crappy movies. I don't care if you give me 50,000, 100,000, 100 million, I'm gonna try to make the best movie I can possibly make, right? So there is an avenue in that way. For comedy, when I started stand up, there was no YouTube, right? And so, like we were talking about how they were passing gin videos through email, on the comedy world, there was an Indian man named Russell Peters that they were sending out that 20 minute clip where he's like, "Tap some bone," and I was like, "Oh my God, this Indian guy is talking crazy." Yeah, college, right? And right now, Russell Peters, only in stand up, is probably one of the highest grossing comics in the world. He makes about $10 million a year. You know what I mean? Now, that has nothing to do with how good he is, because there's plenty of comics that are way better, that aren't as famous. You know what I mean? And that's what this business is. And I want to tell you guys is that if you guys want to help, then you got to support. And that's it. You know what I mean? Like, and I'm not saying we're going to make the best movies yet, but I want you to explain to me why Tyler Perry keeps on making crappy movies. You know what I mean? Why? It's because the blacks support his movies. So whether it's crap or not, they, you know what I mean? Like, they're making money, so why wouldn't a business go, all right, make Madea goes to somewhere, I don't know, go to Iceland. Okay, cool. You know, that's what the idea is. The idea is we can do all this online stuff, but the reason why that when I was in college, there was a movie called Better Luck Tomorrow, and from there till now, there's been a handful of Asian American films, but no one's ever heard of them. Except people like me, because I'm in the industry. You know what I mean? And the reason why is because, yeah, they can get greater movies. Obviously, they're not award-winning movies. But neither is Scary Movie 5. You understand what I'm saying? It's like, it has nothing to do with how awesome or whatever. Obviously, if you make an A-plus movie and it wins awards, great. Right? But even then, you can make alright movies. You know, even comedians are the same. Kevin Hart right now is making so much money doing stand-up. In my opinion, as a professional in the business, is he the best stand-up comic? No. You know? But people are gonna be like, ah, Kevin Hart's the man. He's getting paid. Companies are paying them to be like, hey, wear this t-shirt. I'll give you 10, 20 grand and type in, oh yeah, this t-shirt company is cool. That's how he's making money. Kim Kardashian, who's just an international whore, right, gets paid to wear shoes and clothes and be like, look at me, I like to have sex with black athletes. That's why she's famous. But she gets paid $10,000, $20,000 to tweet this or Instagram that or Periscope it or Snapchat it. You know? That's what I mean by this business, is that as an artist, I can't do that. I'll kill myself before I do that, right? But as a businessman who was a business consultant and I know how money runs, it makes me go, why the heck not? You understand what I'm saying? So if you guys want to support, then go buy an album. Go buy, you know what I'm saying? Go buy some hot dogs. Go, you know what I mean? That's how you help. And I want to say this because 2 weeks ago, I did this comedy special, right, Kings of K-Town. 2 days before the special, I was having dinner with an ex-girlfriend. And we're eating, right? You know, I just wanted material to talk about her later, but then... So we're eating, and I asked her, hey, so are you coming to my show on Thursday? And she goes, no, I can't, I have work. And I wasn't upset, I was like, okay, cool. So I go back to eating sushi. And I guess she felt bad. So she goes, Danny, you know I always mentally support you. What the fuck does that mean? You understand what I'm saying? It's like, people go, I want to support you, I'm going to Kindle head, I'm going to do this for you, but you haven't come to a single show. You haven't bought a single album ticket. You haven't bought anything. You understand what I'm saying? And I told her that. I was like, you can mentally have sex with me 10 times. It doesn't equal to one real sex act. You said that to make yourself feel good, and that's stupid. And I told her that because we're not together anymore, so it doesn't matter. I hate her, right? But that's the issue with people, and we're being a little bit too passive. Asian Americans are one of the highest in terms of spending, but we don't spend it on ourselves. We spend it on Mr. Vuittons and Mr. Chanel's and stuff, but you're not gonna buy, you know, Kim Sun-young's bag or whoever's bag that was famous. You're just brand name whore sometimes. That's why you go, everyone that lives in K-Town here, raise hands. Who lives in K-Town? Look in your apartments. Garages. Does that warrant what the shithole you live in versus the car you drive? That's us. You know what I mean? But you're not supporting, oh, you know what? I'm not gonna watch that movie because, you know, it gotta be funnier. Really? I wanna have a good time. I don't wanna see a crappy movie. Really? So you're gonna spend $200 on the off chance you're gonna have a good night at a drinking place? No?
But I still mentally support you.
That's what I'm saying! That's what I'm saying about all these people. It's like, I don't, look, you don't have to support. If you don't want to, you don't have to support. But then you don't have any say. You don't have any right to complain. That's what I'm saying. Like Sandra Oh, well, you know what everyone says about Sandra Oh? Instead of saying she's a great actress, she's the best Asian American actress we got, you know what they say? She looks like a horse. That's what people say. They go, she's ugly as opposed to her talent. And that's messed up. You know? So reflect on the horse crap that comes out of your mouth, people. Because I didn't see any of you fools at my movie screening. I didn't see any of you at my comedy tapings. You two were there for free. For free. That's my point. I'm not begging for me. If you don't support me, it's fine. But support other Asian American actors that are more talented. Support kids like Dumbfounded. Support people like Far East Movement. Whoever it is, Jin, if that's your thing. Without it, you can't talk about entertainment at all. Because you don't know that the resources that the bigger people have, the only way we can beat it is by supporting. That's the only way. I can't put billboards all over LA, you know what I'm saying? I can't rent out commercial time on your TVs. I can't. Financially, we can't, you know?
So, internet's basically making entertainment more democratic platform so that we could be heard by the big man.
Yes, but the problem, I think, is that it's static versus noise. Before, when it was so expensive to shoot a movie, only people that had the skill and the money could make a movie, right? Now that it's easier for everybody, yeah, there's good amateurs that are coming out and they have a lot of talent, and then there's people that they shouldn't have cameras to begin with, right? But they feel like, you know what? I know how to sing exactly like Michael Jackson, so I'm gonna sit in front of my computer and sing Michael Jackson. And they expect to be famous. And I'm like, why would I buy your album? I would buy Michael Jackson's album. You know what I'm saying? So you understand what I'm saying is that there's a lot of garbage that's going up because of the ease. And on top of that, we're fighting corporations that are jumping in at YouTube. You talk to YouTube stars right now, they don't know how to make money except companies have to go and give them ad money. Here's $100,000, make a video for me. They don't, generating revenue the other way is impossible now.
Okay, for Yo and Ted, Yelp and a lot of other online mobile platforms are changing the way that the restaurants are searched and found. And obviously there's a lot of good things that come with it, but also with it, there are a lot of, new problems that come with it. Did you have to change your business model or the products that you carry or service that you provide because of some of these hardships that online platforms bring to you?
Just like Danny was saying, there's like so much garbage on like YouTube. Nowadays, everyone thinks they're like a food photographer or like a food critic. So everyone's got something to say about each item. But you know, when it comes down to it, you gotta just believe in what product you have. And for us, we start off with, six items? We start with six items. We wanted to model like In-N-Out. It's like you just come there, you know, everything on the menu is good. We don't want to provide you any garbage. And it worked. And, obviously people have their own opinions, their own, problems with their food. But at the end of the day, we knew we had a good product. We were proud of what we put out there. And, you know, all that clutter, the negative Yelp reviews, they balance each other out. And it's funny because I remember when we first started, we had like this one guy that was like, bashing on our food, like, this is garbage, I can't believe people are paying, I can't believe they want the great food truck race. And then we were like, do we respond to this? Do we not respond to this? And then all of a sudden, when we're like about to respond back, like one of our other Yelp people are like, are you stupid? Do you not know food? And they're like fighting each other on Yelp, and the guy's backing us up. So we didn't even have to get involved. And what you realize is you can't please everyone. And as long as you're proud of what you put out there and you know that it's good quality, you put a lot of thought into it. You know, our sausages are all handmade. It's grass-fed meats. You know, it's good stuff, you know? And they're like, I'm not going to pay $7 for a sausage. I get one at 7-Eleven for a dollar. It's like, it's not the same thing, you know? So at the end of the day, like I said, it's if you're happy with the product, it balances itself out. And I think the true people that really understand what we're trying to do will speak on our behalf. And our Yelp profile is still at four stars after 1,000 reviews. And people, you know, constantly give us 5 stars, constantly give us 4 stars. And once in a while, we'll have those 1 stars and we just deal with it, you know? In the beginning, it's like your baby, so you get so prideful when you get that 1 star. And we'd like literally, we get upset and like, we'd like eat us up, like, man, is sauce not that good? But then right after, you'll get like 10 5-star reviews and you let that one 1-star review get to you. But, you know, like I say, eventually you just let it flow and, you know, can't please everyone. And as long as you're proud of what you put out, that's all that matters.
Thank you guys. as a businessman, as an entrepreneur, do you have any new plans? Because like on the internet initiative or offline initiative that you want to share, obviously there might be stuff that you don't want to share, but are there anything you want to share that may help maybe the direction that the audience could take in terms of starting up a business? What's the most cost-effective way of using online, offline media that will actually impact the business?
Let's see, for myself, I think I'm finding myself spending a lot more time offline. I don't know if it's because I'm getting older or whatever, but I just feel like live engagement has become more and more important. And I think live engagement also feeds what's online and creates scenarios that aren't very easily replicable. And I think what's happening with, you know, I guess talent today, I think one thing I really agree with is, I think this has never changed beginning of time, but it comes down to passion. If you're passionate about something, you believe in your product, and you do it long enough, and you're focused on it long enough, chances are you're just really standing in line for your time. I think often the reason a lot of, for me, I think what I realized from within the Asian community why there hasn't been as many, you know, hits or successes is because I think often as Asian Americans we're told to be a certain identity, but I think often the ones that do stand in line does end up gaining time. I mean, you guys seen like so many people who has kind of committed to something and said, you know what, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna go do it. At any given amount of time, because they have a good product and they focus on developing their product, they do get their time. And so I think I'm big on like studying, and these days I'm studying a lot on, you know, how we can further our community in general, just, you know, instead of just individual, but as a group, how we can grow, how we can really engage. And I think there is a bit of disconnect, and I think it's very similar to how YouTube and let's say mainstream entertainment, let's say film production worlds are so different. Film production is owned by a very small population, majority Jews, who really run the industry for years, decades now. And there's a certain system, there's a certain protocol. You know, you come in, there's an assistant that calls, and you know, there's these protocols that if you want to be part of that, you have to learn. I think unfortunately, I think that industry, it's already kind of chased after by so many people, and more, there's more and more Asians in there because now majority of the financing is coming from Asia. And on the other spectrum, on YouTube, I think there's a huge noise discrepancy going on. And I think what's been happening is the length of the life cycle of an act or a brand online is becoming shorter and shorter. Where back then when Jin's video was being passed around, we were touring that album for 4 years. You know, we were like running around and we just kept playing the same song over and over again. Now, if you come out with a hit song, you're lucky if you're on the radio for more than 3 months. And if you have a movie come out, you're lucky if you're in the theater for more than 6 weekends. And so it's just that attention span is getting shorter and shorter. And so I think what's happening on the YouTube and digital side is almost like in comparative to localized TV.
when we were growing up, we had these like cable, I don't really have cable myself, but we would have like local channels, and it'd be like, hey, this is like the, you know, Torrance Network, and we're here to talk about XYZ, and that's the kind of stuff we would kind of see what's going on in our city. Now, I think YouTube and digital media is more like localized TV for culture. And so if you want to find something on food, there's all kinds of localized shows and networks, platforms that you can find food stuff on. And if you want to find something in automobile, you'll find all kinds of channels, networks, you know, within each platform, there's like sub-networks. And so it's getting very focused as far as where we're going as a media, you know, partition, how all that's coming together. But ultimately, I think advice, yeah, I think it comes down to the product. And if you find the community within your product, you'll also be able to lift each other up. Like, for example, like it was great for you guys to get together as three comedians, you know, power of numbers. And I think I'm sure since you guys started Soul Sausage, there's all kinds of love from the food community as well. Of course, there's always guys that aren't going to be within your community, but if you have a like-minded and you share a passion, chances are you guys will support each other. And that's usually what it takes to really get things off the ground. But ultimately, I think you know, I think Nike says it best, just do it. I think that's more important than ever. I think often we tend to overthink ourselves into oblivion. And next thing you know, 10 years has passed and your dream has also passed. And so I think one of the most valuable things we preach at The Great Company is that we're given a lot of resources, whether it's money, whether it's your network, whether it's, you know, your resources, whatever it is. But at the end of the day, all that is worthless because time is your most valuable resource. That's something that takes away every day, every second, and how you spend it is probably one of the most important decisions you have to make in your life. And what the internet offers you is direct access to distribution. And that you couldn't have bought 10 years ago. That direct distribution and that opportunity is no longer there, but you have to in yourself dive much deeper now to find who you are, what you represent. And when you go out there, be as authentic as you can be to what you're doing, so others within your community that can relate in that way can also attach to you and can root for you. And if you give them a reason to share what you're doing, they will share it. And I think that's one of the biggest things and opportunities that's in front of us today. As far as disconnect goes, with kind of the YouTube world and let's say the film world, true talent will rise to the top like anything else. True great products will rise to the top. And you do what you do and people will come find you. And so that's pretty much my perspective.
The audience? Is it an audience or is it? Okay. Okay. What is your question?
Your food has very different cultures kind of mixed into it. It's also sausage, but there's like Hawaiian flavor, there's Japanese flavor, there's Korean flavor, there's Canadian flavor. I mean, your poutines are Canadian foods. So initially, you guys said you guys were in advertising world. How did you start your, of course, new career into food business, embedding all these different cultures into it, we're calling it a soul sausage? And then secondly, is now that you guys have been open, and of course we talked kind of about the negative and the positive of Yelp, but through Yelp, I'm pretty sure there were recommendations and things that people have recommended, and how did you guys kind of implement it in everything to upgrade your
I'm gonna repeat the question real quick so everybody can kind of. I guess the first one alludes to like our menu, how it's just not strictly adhering to just Korean roots. For that one, you know, like we really believe in flexibility as a company and as a brand. And so, you know, when we first started, it was just two sausages, you know. But after a while, you might come back second time, third time, but to eat the same thing over and again, you have to kind of develop your menu. There's like a Japanese reference because of the location we were in. You know, we're just being true to ourselves. We never said soul sausage is just only Korean food, but you kind of have to just adapt and make sure that you have, you know, a sense of who you are. And, you know, these are the things that our chef made that he grew up loving. You know, he had his mother's cooking at home, but he also ate Pizza Hut, Taco Bell, like with his friends. So it's like a fusion, it's a natural reflection of who we are, what we ate. So I guess the menu just came naturally because like, he made it and it tastes good. We're like, we can't just say like it's not Korean, so we can't put on the mat, you know? So that's the kind of thought process of just being adaptable and flexible, especially in the restaurants these days. You have to, you know, like you go to like a restaurant and then like there's always a kale salad because of kale and like, you know, you have to try to appease as much audience as you can, but you still have to be true to yourself. So I hope I answered your question in that regard. In terms of the Yelp question, the second question was, have you, I guess, applied some of these comments to? The big one we adapted to was having beer and liquor with our food, and yes, we do. Now we have a huge restaurant with, you know, a beer that you can eat with a sausage. We all always thought that was our next evolution of soul sausages, you know, eating our food with a nice beer. So in that respect, you know, we took the comments very seriously. But you know, like when it comes down to it, it's your baby, it's your business. You have to dictate, you know, what you're passionate about, what you want to exude. You know, while it's fancy for us to have pictures that are shared on Instagram all the time, you have to remember people have to come back to your restaurant for your restaurant to keep growing and succeeding. So you have to have a certain amount of, you know, core values and core, I guess, items that you want to stand by.
I think you covered everything. I think just regarding the food, I don't think our chef wants to just pigeonhole us into just the sausage company. And since it was like his first platform to really showcase his culinary skills, even on the show, we didn't sell a single sausage. You know, making a sausage takes a lot of time, a lot of machines. And, you know, we didn't want to make sausages all day, you know? Our two sausages that we have, you know, we just love sausages growing up. We love Korean barbecue. It was just a natural progression. And same with all the other items. Like, we grew up eating Spam. We grew up eating, like, potatoes, french fries, Korean fried chicken. And our poutine just has kaibichim on top. It's like, it's delicious, you know? So, yeah, just, like we just have fun with our food, and we just like food that, you know, represents who we are. And at the end of it, we're a brand. And as long as this food fits our brand, we're going to sell it. You know, it's good. Next question.
So, sorry. I'm going to ask for the Kim's Brothers. I know you're very proud of all your product and stuff. And I know Korean food, I know you guys are very successful because you're in the so much diverse area, which is in California. Would you ever guys think about trying different state or out of the world? Like, give them more taste of Korean mixed with their flavor. Like in Germany, they have great sausage, but they don't have any taste buds for Korean. You know, so would you consider that as a possibility?
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, what's it called? The reason why it was like the light bulb came off when I tried Chris's sausage, it was like Germans have sausages, like Chinese people have sausage, like every country has their own sausage, but Korean people don't really have a sausage. They have like sundae, but it's not really sausage, you know? So we figured, yeah, this is perfect. And, you know, I guess we shot a show in Korea. We actually promoted the show by going on a show called 오늘 뭐 먹지 with 성시경 and 신동엽. And we didn't think our food would do well there. We just thought that it was a great promotional opportunity, and these guys would just be like, the hell, it's just a Taipei burger, you know, what the hell, like, what's so special about this? But when they tried it, it was crazy. He, like, Song Shin-young tried it, and he was like, dude, it's Korean, but it's not, it's like American. Like, he was so confused. He was like, what kind of flavor is this? It's like, dude, you eat Taipei every day. It's like Taipei flavored burger. But it was new to him, and he really liked it. And it just made us think that, like, our food is kind of catered, like Young said, for like our generation. It's like this evolution of Korean food, and Korean people don't kind of understand that. So yeah, we definitely want to expand our locations and our sausage. We're trying to produce our sausages at a factory. So once that happens, we'll have more accessibility to ship it all across the country, and maybe even overseas.
I'm gonna ask one question before we go back to the floor. We talked about the business so far, but you know, all the business is about people. And one of the most important people in business is entrepreneur, especially for startups. What is the shittiest, worst moment
as a person, as an entrepreneur, that you remember going through, and how did you get out of it? I think you might have to estimate.
I'm still trying to get out of it. Now, the thing about this business is, in the entertainment business, it's always it makes you jaded. You know what I mean? You're like, I'm funnier than that fool. You know what I mean? But he's famous. Like, if you think like that, you're gonna kill yourself. I'm like, I go crazy going, I know I'm better than that guy. He admits I'm better than him, but he's making millions of dollars, right? And it makes you go, oh. What keeps me going is my faith in, I don't mean in a religious way, my faith in myself. That the reason why I did this, because I know what my former coworkers are making. They're making $500,000 plus. You know, I know what they're making, and I'm not making that, so I should go crazy, right? But instead, it's my faith and my belief that, like he says, it'll rise to the top. People will see it. People will be like, holy crap. You know what I mean? And, you know, there is something here, you know? And the one thing that I want you to know is that Hollywood, he was talking about the, you know, Jews running, you know, the network. I think about the entertainment business like a bunch of cartels, like mafias. You know what I mean? There's a Jew mafia, there's a black mafia, there's a gay mafia, there's a girl mafia, but there is no Asian mafia. You know what I mean? There is no Asian American mafia. Yeah, there's people, you know, people with a lot of money in China that are throwing in money, and they put in Bing Bing Fan or whatever, they put in Yi Byung Hun in Terminator. Terrible movie, by the way. But it's awful. But the reason why they put him in is because they think, yo, this guy is gonna put asses in seats. You know what I mean? Not because he's great. I'll tell you a story. If I had a award-winning script, but I had to have nobody famous attached to it, and I asked for $10 million, they'd be like, you're crazy, right? But if I wrote a two-hour movie about a dude on a toilet, but Brad Pitt was a dude on a toilet, I'm gonna get $10 million. That's the business of it. So if you think about that, you're gonna go crazy because I'm not Brad Pitt. This is what the business does. 10 years ago, there was a comic named Bobby Lee. He was the it guy, the funniest guy that was Asian on TV, right? And then all of a sudden, Ken Jeong came in, and all of a sudden, you don't see Bobby Lee no more, right? Now, as Kim gets big, they're gonna prep up Randall Park. And then once they're done with Ken, that's what's gonna happen. Unless we have a cartel. Unless we make our own stuff, you know? So what I did was, when I was waiting, when I first started, I was waiting, and I was like, yo, when I quit my job, the first month I made 60 bucks. And I was like, homeless people make more than 60 bucks, man. You're gonna die if you keep on doing this. So instead of just waiting for Hollywood to be like, oh, here's an audition, come and do this, I had to be like, screw it, man. I gotta make my own gigs. I gotta figure it out, you know? And I think, the entrepreneurial spirit of me going, I was so broke once, I'll tell you something. I was so broke once, and I broke both my ankles, so I couldn't walk. Remember? Remember when I had it? Yeah, I was walking like I just came out of prison, and I was cute. You know what I'm saying? I was walking like, ooh, it was real cute. Yeah, and there was nothing to eat in my house because I couldn't drive. I couldn't leave the house. I couldn't walk. Right? And I looked in my fridge, and all I had was bang and udon. Have you ever had an ice cube sandwich before? That's when I knew, man, you need a chumshin cheddar, Danny. You can't just wait for life, you know, to give you opportunities. You gotta make your own, you know? That's what made me go, all right, I'm gonna go perform anywhere I can. You know what I mean? Not even just for money, I would go anywhere. I performed at a biker gang convention. I performed at a crack rehab center. I performed inside a laundromat. You know what I mean? And to me, I'm thinking to myself, why am I doing this? And the only reason why I'm doing it is because I believe that I'm good enough. I don't mean famous or big or whatever, but I know I'm talented enough to make it in this business, and that's what keeps me going. I don't eat ice cream sandwiches anymore. Just, look at it, you can't maintain this with ice cream sandwiches. Chan mo go. Yes, sir?
Hey, how was the Super Bowl commercial experience?
I've done about like 10 or 11 national commercials in the last 5 years. It's funny because I don't know if you remember, there was a commercial about Loctite. A bunch of weird looking fools with fanny packs and they're dancing uglily, you know? It was good, but you know what they're looking for. That's what I'm saying. Like, I'm not gonna ever, me and Lee Byung-hun are not gonna fight for the same role. I'm never gonna be T-2000 or 1000 or whatever that fool is. He's too good looking, he's that John.
T-2 million.
Yeah. I'm gonna play just a fat Kim Jong-un lookalike. You know what I mean? Like, and I know what that role is, right? So, you know, they think you're funny looking. You know? But whatever, man, I gotta not eat autumn sandwiches, man. So was it amazing? I mean, I don't know if you, like, you know, any basketball fans here, but I did a commercial with Kobe. You know? Now I'm what? Now is that's what it is? Huh? Same name brand whores over here. Kobe 하니까 정신 차려? Huh? But that's what I mean. Like, you know, the thing is, it's like, yeah, it was a paycheck. It was fun. And that's the thing. I picked this, so I'm not going to go on set and be like, I'm too good for this. I'm going to dance like an idiot. You know what I mean? That's what I did. So it was fun.
All right, cool. Thank you. Any other questions?
I have a question for Danny.
Hold on one second.
Oh, nice.
I just have one question for Danny Cho.
Okay.
Are you on YouTube?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, because I noticed there's a lot of people nowadays that the online to offline,
yeah.
Actually now there's a lot of YouTube celebrities.
Yeah.
They start up on YouTube and then their fame creeps into like real life,
mm-hmm.
And they're on like TV commercials or movies and stuff. And so, yeah, like that's another thing to think about, and that's got me thinking a lot about you know, like people that put content on social media, and especially YouTube, like they can build up a following, and then from there on, they have a base of supporters, and then from there they can move on, or it could be the other way around. Celebrities that are already famous go on YouTube, and it's just an interesting exchange.
So what was your question? Are you the next one?
I was finished.
Are you giving me advice on my career right now?
Just
I don't tell a chef how to cook, stupid. What are you talking about? There was no question there. He just said, oh, there was a question. I am on YouTube, yeah.
This is a question for the Sausage Brothers. So, Ted, you mentioned that you guys didn't sell out. So, what was like a significant business choice you guys had to make? Or is she had a face that, was it like a financial aspect? Or
a lot of it was financial. We got offers to open like in Hawaii, New York, Seattle. We said no to all of them in the beginning because we were still trying to figure out who we are. One of our first investors, he definitely had leverage on us. We had no store, we had no credit, so he had gave us a ridiculous offer. And we thought about it for a day, we're like, damn, we'd be giving away so much of the business. And that no was the best decision we made in our lives because we waited. And we waited and we got an awesome deal. So yeah, we didn't give in. That's, you know, like if you really, really, really want to make your dreams come true, a lot of it you have to sacrifice, you have to pay your dues, you know? But, you know, a lot of the things that we did well in the beginning was we did learn when to say no, you know? Especially as an entrepreneur, you want to take any opportunity, you want to take gigs at a laundromat, you want to do all these things, and it's great, you know? But like, sometimes you have to say no, right? Something to say no, hold out for the better opportunity. I think that's what Ted was alluding to, you know, we're still kind of like this family mentality where, you know, we try to promote like non too kind of corporate kind of approach where we're just, you know, like we want to be at least seem like we could have like somebody that you could have beer with, you know? And that's, I think that's kind of the charm of, in the beginning, like that's who we were. We're just three normal dudes that didn't really care about making money, but just wanted to promote good food and, you know, good times, especially with a new product like the Korean barbecue sausage. So I hope that answers your question.
Hi, this question is for Carl. I'm very interested in your Seed Center, which is your headquarters. I wanted to know about approximately how big your venue is, and since it's a fully equipped venue for instance, like a recording studio, production stage, or what kind of hourly rates do you have, or is it more for per event? How many people can you seat? Would Ulta be allowed to hold an event there?
Yeah, so
you
like 16 questions right there, but I'll try to answer what the Seed Center is. So I think the best way to describe it is a treehouse for the creatives. And the initial intention of it was to create a space where, when I had believed that the new renaissance of creativity is coming into town, specifically south of downtown Los Angeles Art District, that I want to build a space where creatives can congregate and collaborate. And so, you know, at one point there was just this vision that really fell on my lap, where I just believed that, man, if we could put the recording studio next to the performance stage, next to our offices, next to a collaborative space where we'd be closer to the artists that we work with, we could perhaps create something, a synergy that's beyond what's out there, and create something that's a vertical value that has strength when it goes to market. It's about 7,000 square feet, and in the course of the last 2-3 years, it's evolved a lot, because not only has it been our office operationally, but we've started hosting different events. I mean, we have Soul Sausage at some of the releases, and since then we've had countless events, and it's gone from these corporate gatherings to, you know, for example, like this last week, Hollis, she's a singer on Macklemore's White Walls, and she's actually Asian as well, and you know, that was one of the biggest videos of last year, and you know, she's rehearsing on there on an every other day basis now, and we'll have, you know, guys who's producing the next track for Snoop coming into our studio, and they'll use the studio for a couple of days, and it's been a very constant evolution and rotation of artists, and so it's been kind of a weird thing. We're trying to figure out what it is exactly, but currently, it's been, you know, a venue that's really harnessed a lot of creativity. And the reason we call it Seed Center is because during the journey of when I got there, I had taken some time off. And, you know, during that time off, I wanted to really kind of figure out where my life is. And I realized at the end of the day, what you do in this life with your time is really just seeding things. And often you may or may not see the fruits of it all, but the idea is if I could be part of all these great things that would come out of the Seed Center, then I think I fulfill my personal destiny. And so one of the things we really believe in at the great company is you can't fulfill your destiny until you help someone else fulfill theirs. And so countlessly we do our best to create this giving culture. And so when people come in, we do our best to really live up to this, you know, giving nature, because we believe that everyone in this room remembers and always to give to each other instead of taking from each other. We'll never be lacking, because if we're always taking from each other, we'll always be lacking. And so I think our whole concept for us is really to impact culture at a very micro level, and in believing that by going deep, we can go wide. And so that's definitely, you know, why it's been a very ambitious project overall. And you guys are all welcome to come by. We're in downtown Los Angeles, kind of a developing area of the Arts District. It's gotten a lot crazier since we moved in 3 years ago. Since then, we have Stumptown Coffee has moved in, Blue Bottle, and so and Bestia, some of the, you know, greatest restaurants and roasteries have moved in around our proximity. So we're kind of right in the center of it, of that southern area. And so it's been kind of cool. We get a lot of people visiting these different vendors, and they'll stop by and say hi. And so it's been an honor serving there, and, you know, kind of hosting all the people that comes in and out.
I have two questions for Danny and for the Silk Sausage. So my first question to Danny is, you were saying like Russell Peters, he makes like $10 million, and he's like a really, he's making a lot of money, but
then do you think that, like, maybe, like, what do you think that they're doing right and we're doing wrong? Because it's not like a money difference that, like, we have a lack of money that we can't go out and support artists like you. It's not like the Black community has more money so that they're supporting their artists. Like, what is it, do you think that really is our problem that prevents us from doing that? Or, and what do you think, like, people like Russell Peters is right to be as well as you?
For Russell, I think it was the right place at the right time. I don't think that he is, I mean, I think he's a funny comic, but I don't think he's a legend. You know what I mean? He's not a Richard Pryor, or he's not a George Carlin, who in the comedy world, they were the greats, right? I think it was an anomaly, and he's a super talented, funny dude that has a lot of accents. You know what I mean? It's crazy to see an Indian dude talk like a Chinese guy. Right? Like, Indian, that Indian person, like, this is our stupid brain. Like, I was in Queens one time, in New York, and I went to a Dunkin' Donuts, and I said, how much is this? And the Indian guy said, sambur samchipchan, right? And I went, like, you'll never forget that, you know what I mean? And so, I mean, I'm not saying Russell really talks like that, but the point is that on the support side, it's because we're lazy, let's be honest. Laziness, it's way easier to not do something than do it.
And do you think, like, the Black community, like, I'm just taking it as an example, they are much more proactive in mm-hmm. their community?
They have they used to have programs, I don't know if they still have it, but back in the days, they would have these newsletters and email chains where if a Black actor was, like, starring in a movie, they would flood the community saying, yo, you gotta hit it up the first week. Because the way the theater business works is that if your movie doesn't perform, there's no contract to say we're going to run this for 2 weeks or 3 weeks. If it doesn't perform that first week, it's out. You know? So it's important for those weekends for the theaters to be full. So, like, I forget what the, because I used to be on the email chain, I'm not Black, but I don't know why, but they would, like, yo, this movie's out, boom. Let's support our people. And there is none of that movement. And the other part is the fact that, yeah, there's a lot of Asians, but then Asians sometimes are racist against each other, culturally. And that's another issue. You know what I mean? Like, especially in a place like LA where there's a lot of all kinds of Asians, like, that's why they're like, you know, some people get mad, some Koreans get mad when Chinese people come and ruin Kamadong Pekcheong or whatever because, you know, but that's what they say, you know? But it is what it is. They keep, you know, the restaurants like it because they're making money, you know? But that in other towns like Austin, Texas, there is no difference between Chinese or Korean. They go to, like, oh, it's a Vietnamese night or something, and everybody goes. Oh, it's a Korean this event, and then, like, everybody goes. And I feel like we have a lot to learn from those other smaller towns because it's more beautiful to see than us going, ugh, I'm not going to the 626. You know what I'm saying? Like, that kind of feeling. So, you know, those are two.
You guys have had, like, a lot of, like, congratulations on the movie and the taping and all that. And you guys had a lot of popularity at South by Southwest, right? So do you think maybe your target market maybe isn't to the Asian community? But because, you know, how Cape Town in the last couple of years is not really Cape Town. You come here on the weekends, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Go out, it's not a bunch of Korean people, it's a bunch of non-Korean people. Do you think, because there's such a big love and a big, like, attention towards, like, the Korean restaurants, the Korean murabangs and all the kind of things, that maybe your market is more non-Korean? Because, like, by the way, to the person who was asking if he has a YouTube page, he does. He's had it for a long time and has had a following for a while. There's a lot of, like, if you look at the comments, a lot of non-Asian people who are also really interested in, like, your web series and all of that. Do you think they're maybe more of your target audience?
Here's what I want to say. Like, it's because we live in this town, we see that. But let's be honest, if Cape Town Cowboys or any Asian American movie that no one really famous is in plays in, like, Idaho or plays in, like, Iowa, they'd be like, what is this? Like, there's no way that we can compete with, like, Jurassic World or whatever. Right? I'm not saying my movie's better or worse, but I'm just saying that Even you guys, 어느 거 볼래? Jurassic Park 볼래? K-Town Cowboys 볼래? I bet you most of you are like, let's go see Jurassic Park. It's, I can see it in 3D. 알았어요, 내려요. And so what I mean by that is that it starts from within. All movements, like you were talking about earlier about a niche. I didn't want to do just K-Town related stuff. But I also believe you only write and you should create what you know how to create. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's why I don't tell these guys, hey, you know what? You should make chorizo mandu. You know what I mean? Like, I wouldn't do that because I don't know what it takes to make it good. You know what I'm saying? And so I know what I know, and I live in this area, and my stand-up is not about being Korean, actually, right? It's about worse stuff, like X-rated stuff, you know, chukiahe, right? But you know, that's what I know. That's what I know. So I think the idea is if I look at the analytics and where all people come from, I do a podcast, a weekly podcast, all the interactions I get, the majority are Asian. You know, it is what it is, you know. Asian men, because girls don't like me. I don't know why. You know,
and then I
sorry,
really quick question. So to sausage, I work for a company in Boarding, and we just branched out into the restaurant business, and we're doing a pizza franchise. So the biggest dilemma that we're faced with is that there's some, we're kind of like a pile, like, we don't like to call ourselves that, but what we're faced with is everything. So we're a little bit more expensive in biology, but we feel that we need better ingredients, better quality, and all of that. So our franchise people, they're concerned about, hey, you know, there's a biology, you guys cost more, you guys are all doing the same thing. Why don't you guys just crap your machine and crap your quality and just do the same thing? What would you get, like, what would you be your advice to, like, a company that has so many similar competitors, but, like, trying to maintain quality, or
do we
be the same, or do we set ourselves apart? I mean, like, how would you guys, like, overcome
that? That's a really tough question. But, I mean, for me, the first thing that pops into my mind is everything you just said right now, it's all branding, right? So, what you just told me about the competitive advantages over the biology is what you need to really, you know, showcase out and promote the market, you know? I think if people know that you're, you know, the ingredients are chickens, like cage-free, all natural, they're gonna gravitate towards that more. I'm a huge fan of Chipotle. I think they're doing a lot of cool stuff. They're bringing really good quality food to the masses, and they're cheap at pork, right? And then they're like, we're not gonna sell pork because we want to cheapen our brand by eating crappy pork, you know? So yeah, I think if you guys just really promoted and pushed heavily on like the healthy aspect of it, there's a lot of people out in LA that are willing to pay an extra buck if they knew that, you know, if they knew where their product came from. And I think a lot of these people, especially in LA, they're very health conscious, but they want to know where their food derived from. So if you tell them that story, it'll be a better chance to compete against biologists.
We have about 10 minutes, and I actually want to ask you guys, we're all here because, you know, we want to be entrepreneurs, we want to be successful, we want to make a lot of money, we want to be somebody better than who we are today. I want to know, from, you know, your mind, your goals, when you are all the way successful, imagine yourself all the way successful at the pinnacle of your career, whatnot. Can you describe yourself, your future you, at the pinnacle of your career? Not what your company is, but you.
I think I know what you're trying to do. I always, when I was like little, I always thought, you know, I'd want a mansion and buy an island or whatever, but as you get older, like, for me, my definition of success is just still being able to connect with people, even if I have like hundreds of stores and still come back and just, you know. This is a transparent age where you have to be open and honest. And back to your question, lady in the back, like, you have to be transparent. You have, like, as a restaurant, you have to know who you are. And the thing is, like with us, like, we have an open kitchen, so you can see everything that's going on. If there's a fight, you know there's a fight. But just going back to your question, I just think that you have to be able to connect with people, and I think that's something that I want to make sure that, we have, like, even our next door, you could see through the glass to the kitchen. Just having that connection. I mean, that's for me. Like, I want to make sure that even though I might have a successful business, I don't want to be, like, disconnected from the world. That's my idea of success. I think Carl, his vision is awesome because you promote community and you grow, and you grow with that community. Like, deeper is wider. I mean, that's such a great quote. So, I mean, I don't think our goal is financial wealth. It's just more like representing our community well, you know, like having good food and making sure that I'm still part of that process with and connecting with the people, even no matter how successful we get. I mean, I know that's kind of corny, but that's kind of the mantra that we've been following. We work at Soul Sausage like once or twice a week just to make sure that we can connect with the people. And they're like, oh, you're still here. I'm like, oh, yeah, of course, you know? So, I mean,
I want money. I know, just for me, I think the big one for me is, like I said, there's no Korean sausages out there. So if we can get that out to the world and let them know that, you know, we can make good sausage, that would be really cool.
My first role model and hero was my Halmari. And she passed away when I was 13. And right before she died, she told me one thing, and I'll never forget it. She said, 그냥 떳떳하게 살면 돼. Right? That's just being, and to me, that's being righteous. It's about not in a God way or whatever, but righteous amongst whatever you're doing. You know what I mean? I never wanted to be famous. I never did this for money. If I did this for money, I'd still be a consultant. You know what I'm saying? I do this because I'm righteous. And when I get successful, I want to look back and be like, yeah, I didn't screw up too much. I live righteously. I don't want to regret not doing this. You know? And in terms of, like, you know, monetarily or whatever, I don't need it. I always say to my friends, I don't need 10 million fans or whatever. I just need 100,000 people to give me $100 in their lifetime. I'd be good, you know what I'm saying? That's not hard. Right? That's what I mean. It's just, you know, it's not about that. To me, Bill Burr has a joke. Don't be the guy with the boat. Be the guy with the friend with the boat. Right? So you don't have to worry about docking fees and gas. You just have a friend and you be like, I brought the beers. You wanna be that guy. You don't wanna, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I agree. A great company. So be a great company that owns boats. And yeah, no, it's true. I think your network is everything. And I think through time, I think as an entrepreneur, there's the ups, the downs, the ups and the downs, and your values change. Like I can't say, you know, 7 years ago I could say I knew where I would be doing today, or even 7 years ago, before that, I knew what was real or not. But a lot of dreams has come true in my lifetime, and I think if any of you put your mind to it, it will come true. I think it's just if you're really committed. So I think for me, I would say 14 years ago, my biggest thing was to see an Asian get a platinum record. Wow, great, saw that, you know, it's crazy, didn't think I would see in my lifetime. Then my next thing was, oh, we could see, I want to see an Asian on a television show as a lead. And so now it's happening in September, Daniel Wu as a lead on Badlands, which is the show opening right after Walking Dead. And for me, it was an honor for the last 7 years seeing that whole thing develop. And then, you know, I think where I am now is, you know, the company is a great priority, but even bigger priority is family, like, you know, with Min back there, my girlfriend, want to really build a family with her and do something that's very practical and I think a really big part of my value. So I think when I see my life 7 years, I think the value would be more of, you know, having our kids, having all our families together and spending quality time and be able to support the artists that I continue believing in. And so I think it just continues evolving and it becomes more and more ambitious because as humankind, we tend to become numb to old dreams and want to build bigger dreams. And that's why you see Richard Branson never stopping because he keeps going and wants to, like, and you know, Elon Musk wants to, like, time travel and stuff. And so they'll never stop. But I think one thing you have to realize is not everything's under your control. And I think for me, faith does play a big part, as far as I am a very small piece in a much, much bigger blueprint that I may or may not understand. And all I can do really is to impact the people that I get to and have the privilege to touch and connect with while I'm alive. And so my thing is, it constantly changes. It is a moving target, but I think what it comes down to, if you can lay down and know that you've been true to yourself and everything you've ever wanted to do and pursued your dreams, even you pursuing a dream may have impacted someone to actually fulfill that dream after you're long gone. And so I think we build on generations. And so, you know, we might not have the awesome community now, but I think as long as we hold on to it, grasp onto that, I think one day it will happen. And so, yeah, that's kind of what I see. All right, this is our panel.